Grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. It was the fifth inning, game three of the 1932 World Series when Babe Ruth stepped up to the plate. His New York Yankees were tied 5-5 with the Chicago Cubs. The first pitch, strike one. Then Ruth pointed to the flag that stood in right center field, some 440 feet away. Strike two. Ruth pointed again. When the third pitch came, it was a curveball. It connected with Babe Ruth's bat and launched like a rocket straight into center field over the fence. Probably the most famous home run ever hit. Why? Because Babe Ruth called his shot. Now, how many of us haven't been Babe Ruth wannabes at times, playing a game of pickup, picking up the bat in our hands and pointing out to center field only to hit a dribbling ground ball to shortstop for an easy out? I think we all get it. We all understand that it is one thing to call your shot and it is a completely different thing to deliver. Today we hear Jesus call his shot in an incredible way. He claimed to be able to raise the dead. In fact, he went one step further. He pointed to himself and said, "I am the resurrection and the life, that all who believe in me will not die but live." That's quite a claim. I have to tell you that I don't hold it against anyone who thinks Christians are a little nuts for believing that we will never die. The fact is, that does sound crazy, coming out of anyone else's mouth but Jesus. Yet we believe it. Why? Because Jesus called his shot, and then he followed it with action. And that claim of Jesus that we hear today, that he is the resurrection and the life, that claim is at the center of our Christian faith. And notice this, Jesus, with these words, is addressing our biggest problem. He's addressing death itself. How does someone apart from Jesus deal with death? I think we've all seen it. We've probably all lived it at one point. How do you deal with death if there is no Jesus? Well, when you're young, you just don't think about it because, you know, it's never going to happen to you. And I suppose as life goes on, you try not to think about it by filling your life with anything that can distract you from that idea, imagining that if you could fill life with purpose and meaning, death will stay out of the way. Of course, we know billions and billions of dollars are spent every year. Why? To try to hold on to some semblance of youthfulness, to try to stave off death just a little bit longer with some medical procedure, some operation. And finally, when someone gets close to death, the dying are put away in facilities that we can go and visit and then go back home to our nice comfy places. And even when someone has died, what do we do to console ourselves apart from Jesus? Well, we say things like, "At least she's not suffering anymore," as if we're so certain that life after death is better than life before it. How does Jesus confront death? How does he deal with it? He deals with it head on. He deals with death by undoing it. This was the shot that he called when he said, "I am the resurrection and the life." Of course, Mary and Martha had death on their minds when their beloved brother Lazarus was sick. They called for Jesus that he might come and do something, but Jesus delayed. And by the time he arrived, it had been 4 days. 4 days since Lazarus had breathed his last. 4 days that his body had been sitting in a tomb. And notice what Jesus didn't say to Martha when she came out to meet him. He didn't say, "I'm so sorry for your loss." No, he said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die." That, friends, is calling your shot. That doesn't mean that for Christians death has no sting, or that we eagerly look forward to death. Even in this account, Jesus, we're told, wept there with those who were mourning Lazarus. But unlike us, who are completely helpless, have nothing to say to stave off death, Jesus has power even over death. Jesus, in fact, speaks to death. And when he does, death obeys. Or maybe better put, Jesus speaks to a dead man. "Lazarus, come out." And death coughed up its last victim. Our Lord Jesus called his shot. He delivered by knocking death out of the grave, so that we have good reason to put our faith in him. Jesus said to Martha, after he had spoken those famous words, he said, "Do you believe this? Do you believe that I am the resurrection and the life, that whoever lives and believes in me will not die?" So I'll ask you today, do you believe those words of Jesus? I know my audience, I know that you in fact do believe, that you confess like Martha, Jesus is the Christ, he is the Savior, he is God's own Son. But I think it's worth for us to pay close attention to those words that Jesus said. He said, "Whoever lives and believes in me will never die." Those two words go together, whoever lives and believes in me. We tend to only think of the latter one, believes in Jesus. But you can't have one without the other. I think if you ask most people, in fact, statistically, most people in our area will say to a survey, "I believe in Jesus." What they mean is they believe Jesus existed. They might even believe that he died and that he rose again. It's easy to have this idea of faith that when you die, God will hand you a quiz. And on the quiz, there's one question. Do you believe in Jesus? Mark yes or no. And faith is knowing that the right answer is yes. But that's not how Jesus talks about faith. And I wonder if we were to examine the lives of those who say, "I believe in Jesus," if we would see this, that they are living in him right now. When Jesus talked about those who live and believe in him, he wasn't talking about some future thing that might happen to Christians. He's talking about a present reality. And I think for Christians, this is one of the great misconceptions about Christianity. That our faith has one goal, one purpose, and it's this: when I die, I'll go to heaven one day. As if our faith has nothing to say about the present and only promises something in the future. And we go through all this Christianity thing so that when we die, then we'll go to heaven. I have an illustration for you today. Which of these two better describes the Christian life according to the Bible? I have two lights. One is a flashlight that needs a battery, and the other is a work lamp that has a cord. Which of these two, let's sit it right here, better describes the Christian life? I suppose it would be easy to think that when God grants us life, it's like he gives us a battery that we plug into our light, click it on, and we have life. We have life as long as the battery has power, but when the battery dies, well, that's when our life ends. If this is the case, then faith in Jesus is kind of like having a backup battery. It's like having a backup battery. The good thing about this one is that it will never run out. In the meantime, though, as long as our battery is running strong and our light is shining, what do we do with the backup? Well, we tuck it away on the shelf in the garage. We forget about it until the moment that we might need it. The problem is this, if we think of our faith like a flashlight running off our own power, our own battery, then Jesus is not really someone that we need right now, not in this moment, not as long as our light is shining bright and our life seems to be going well. When do you start to think about Jesus? Well, when the light starts to flicker, or when you press the little button and it says there's only one bar of power left. When it seems that your life is coming close to its end, that's when you say, oh, Jesus, he is important. But in the meantime, I don't need to think about him all that often. He's not the source of my life. I don't need to go to church, things like that. That's the case if we see our life kind of like a flashlight with a battery. The problem is, Jesus said, whoever lives and believes in me. He's not just talking about a future thing, but a present reality. Our life is not like a battery pack that when it runs out, we'll plug in Jesus and we'll be okay. Our life is more like a light that has a cord. Now let me see if this works. Plug it in and you have light. But when it's unplugged, there is no light, there is no life, not apart from Jesus. Yet connected to him, there is a never-ending source of light and of life. You know, friends, it is to our shame when we live disconnected from our Lord. It's to our shame when we imagine that we can go through life and claim the name of Christ, but not see our need for him or not live in him every single day. When instead of the joy that is ours in Jesus, we allow fear and worry to grip our hearts. When instead of giving thanks to God for all of his wonderful gifts like family and good health and meaningful work and those hobbies that make life interesting, we turn these gifts of God into our God as if our life was just about pursuing them, and we neglect the greater gifts of Christ and his word. It's to our shame when instead of looking to find peace alone in Christ, we look to find peace in this world, or in the approval of those of this world, and not in the forgiveness that is ours in him. The good news is that today is another day of God's grace. To be a Christian does not mean that we don't fall into sin. It means that we daily turn from our sins in repentance, that we die to sin, that we might live in Christ. This is what St. Paul was saying in our second lesson. He said, if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. To live in Christ is to die to sin. It's to know that every one of my sins was laid on Jesus, and he took them to a cross, and they were buried with Jesus in a tomb, and I was buried there with Jesus, that I too have been raised with Jesus. As surely as I am baptized, I have life in him. To live in Christ is to live connected to this truth, that my life is not bound to this world, but it is bound to my Lord, in whom there is no death. After all, he called his shot, and he knocked death out of the grave for you. When we think about why it is that we gather here every Sunday, I hope you see that this is the reason. I was looking at some statistics from a religious survey done in our area, and it's over 60% of people who say you do not need to go to church to be a Christian. I read that and I was thinking to myself, what passage could I come up with? What argument could I make to someone who might say something like that? But I think that's the wrong approach. instead of trying to argue with people or finding the right Bible passage, and they do exist, wouldn't it be better for us as Christians to demonstrate with our own lives, with our own priorities, why it is that gathering for worship is the first thing that we do on the first day of the week? Many of you know that here at Redeemer, we're doing a year-long effort to renew our mission, the mission that Christ has given our church. And each one of you is a part of this mission. Part of this effort is that Jay, our elder, and I are reaching out to the members of Redeemer, encouraging us to make this time together around Jesus' word and his sacrament as a priority for each one of us. And it's not just because we're passionate about people coming to church. It's because we're passionate about people remaining connected to Christ. Whoever lives and believes in him has life. And that is what we want for every single one of us and for those who are not yet here, that we would have life in Jesus, life eternal. You know, Babe Ruth called his shot, but even this legend has been challenged. There are some people who were there that day who insist Babe Ruth was not pointing to center field. He was pointing to the Cubs dugout because they were heckling him as he was at this at-bat. What happened? The newspaper man saw Babe Ruth point, and he ran with the story that he was pointing out to the flag in center field. And of course, Babe Ruth was happy to go along with it. I mean, who wouldn't want to say that he called this shot and then knocked one out of the park? Whether he pointed to center field or not, maybe we'll never know. But this we know for certain. Our Lord Jesus, he called his shot as the resurrection and the life. And he delivered with action, calling Lazarus out of the tomb, being raised himself on the third day. And he too will call us out of the tomb on that last day. And he already has given each one of us eternal life that we would live now in him. Amen.